since the Industrial Revolution, if not before, energy has been at the heart of change, of prosperity around the world. Over the next 20, 30 years, we're going to see change on a scale that we've never witnessed before. We have many, if not most, of the technologies we need to reach net zero. Battery storage, pumped hydro, and the role of digitalization that will manage supply and demand far more efficiently than we've seen today. We end up with an energy system sometime later in this century, which is fundamentally different from the one we've had for the last century. The energy transition is effectively a complete rewiring and a replumbing of the energy system as it sits today. My name's Nick Wayth, and I'm the Chief Executive of the Energy Institute. So the Energy Institute is the chartered membership body for energy professionals around the world. We've got a very simply stated purpose, which is to accelerate a just energy transition to net zero. Every aspect of modern life is dependent on energy, and for most of history, fossil fuels have driven that. And today still account for over 80% of how we consume energy. I think we can get to a world where we have low carbon, secure and affordable energy and continue our way of life, but also share that prosperity with those that don't have it today. If we're going to solve this challenge and opportunity, we need the brightest minds from every sector working together, but then to grow them at scale and at pace. So the world is electrifying, and electricity demand around the world is growing at about twice the rate of overall energy demand. And we see that as whole societies begin to electrify. There's a huge role of technology. And actually, on the one hand, I would argue that we have many, if not most, of the technologies we need to reach net zero today. So the pathway to net zero is not fully charted yet. There are many scenarios out there that you can go and look at. Number one, the continued growth in renewables. Renewables have grown at an exponential rate, roughly tripling over the last decade. And most forecasts out there would expect to see that continued level of growth, which has been driven by the continued decline in the costs of those technologies. The challenge clearly with renewables is they work very well when it's windy and sunny, but less so when it's not. And so there's a big opportunity around how we integrate those into the existing energy system, but also develop technologies that will help manage that variability. The role of batteries is going to be really important as we try to manage the variability of wind and solar in the energy system. So as we see exponential growth in batteries, we're also going to see huge demand for some of the key metals and minerals that go into those batteries: lithium, cobalt, nickel. And we know that many of those resources come from challenged geographies where there are human rights issues and other challenges. And so I think we're going to see an evolution of the battery chemistry, and in some instances that may create less dependency on some of those more challenging minerals. There's been a huge amount of focus and even hype around hydrogen over the last few years. And so there's been a lot of focus around the role of hydrogen in transportation, in heating. I would say hydrogen is more likely to play a role in heavy industry and really the areas that cannot be easily electrified. Today, the world uses about 100 million tons per year of hydrogen. Now, that hydrogen isn't green. It's largely black or grey hydrogen, which is made from fossil fuels. We need to decarbonize where we're already using hydrogen. Fusion is a really interesting technology. It's how the sun works. It has huge potential for low carbon, almost abundant energy. But today we're still operating in the lab scale. We've recently hit some important milestones with fusion energy for the first time, very briefly providing net positive energy output. We need to develop that technology much, much further in the lab and then ultimately commercialize it. If we can untap the potential of fusion energy, it has got the potential to be a game changer. So transportation of energy has been critical for energy security. There is a role for more localized generation that is closer to the consumer and reduces some of that need to transport energy around the world. There are potentially different ways to transport energy around the world. We may have high voltage DC cables which allow electricity to be transmitted over many thousands of kilometers without significant losses. I think what's important in each of these choices is that we optimize the solution and don't just apply today's thinking into tomorrow's world. So the energy transition clearly faces some hurdles. I think firstly, we've got some huge challenges around the grid infrastructure. So if you look around the world, in almost every geography, the list of projects that are being built or being planned far exceeds the capacity of the grid. And we need to find ways of accelerating the ability to connect projects onto the grid by accelerating planning, permitting, and the physical infrastructure we need. We're going to have to build a lot more grid in the coming decades to really ensure we have an energy transition. Fossil fuels will continue to play an important role in the production of petrochemicals. But I do see a world where fossil fuels, first coal, and then oil, and then gas, will play less and less of a role. I genuinely believe this transition is not only about reducing carbon, but actually it's about creating far more healthy environments everywhere we can consume and produce energy. It's about that energy being secure, locally sourced where it makes sense, and also more affordable than it is today. Thank you.